So today I would like to introduce the Sankarshan Sahu to all of you. He is currently pursuing his joint masters from University of Paris Diderot and Sorbonne University. So hello bhaiya, how are you?
Yeah, I'm fine. Thank you for this opportunity, and I gave especially the opportunity to share my experience, especially here in France. I think it will help a lot of you, though the path is not conventional per se, but yeah, if you want to follow something unconventional.
So, bhaiya, from when did you start feeling passionate about quantum physics that you decided to set it up as your prime goal?
Okay, so the thing is, from 11th and 12th, I always liked physics. And it was sort of a rash decision to take up engineering. I really didn't explore other options. So after I took up engineering, there's a thing in me like, I really want to do tough, challenging thing. And I was watching Big Bang Theory, and there were a lot of talk about quantum physics. And people even say that quantum physics is tough. It's perhaps the future. So I started studying it. There's an course by Professor Barton Zwieback on MIT, courseware, open courseware, and also on edX platform. I just took the course. I really loved the professor and really loved what it was, what entire quantum physics and quantum mechanics in general was all about. So it was from there that my real passion for quantum physics stemmed out. And then sooner rather than later, in my second year, we had a physics course, right? And we had a basics of quantum physics as well. Even there, I got a bit interested. And after I came to my second year, during my engineering, I realized that I'm perhaps more suited for doing quantum physics than engineering. So then it was from there on, I think. The onset was there in the first year, but it was from the second year that I decided, yeah, that this is a viable career option, and I'll be pushing for it.
So as we know that quantum physics is a really hard subject and civil engineering subjects are vast. So in the initial stage, how did you push yourself towards quantum physics, keeping a balance in the civil engineering subjects as well?
Yeah, so that might be tough, finding the right balance. So what I did was I studied quantum physics for most of the time, and before my exams, say 2 to 3 weeks, I really got serious about my engineering subjects as well. And what I used to do is whatever was taught in the class, I would just maybe go over and read it in my hostel for an hour or two. And after that, I would just go to library and study quantum mechanics and different, not only quantum physics, I studied physics in general a lot. So there's electrodynamics, there's classical mechanics, and there's quantum mechanics, which I like to study. So there are, like, it's difficult to find the balance, but after a few days, after say a few weeks, a few months, you'll get the hang of it, that what you need to do to survive in engineering, at least to get a good passing grade, which I believe is not that difficult. And as well, follow your own pursuit, own passion, whatever else you want to do. Like, yeah, people even do it for MBA, CAT. Even that is not that much related to engineering, but people do that, right? And you will be able to do it if you have the correct discipline to do it and the correct passion to follow, the correct will to do it. It's not that big of a deal.
So generally, when we are entering college, we find friends, we go for to tea shops, and throughout the day, we remain busy with some of the other college activities. Yeah. There are so many clubs and other things as well. So didn't you feel that, no, you want to do you want to prioritize those things more than quantum physics? Like, you had to work really hard to balance it. No, you had to give at least 5 or 6 hours every day. So
not really. Yeah. But yeah, the thing about college is it's your time. Nobody is controlling you. And it's on yourself to find the right balance. Yeah. Even I hang out with friends. I've played even football in my last 2 years. Especially the third year, I played a lot of football during the evening. And I even went out with friends, hanged out with them, with movies. But yeah, but maybe not as much as other guys did. Maybe because there's a restriction on the demands of the subject or the thing I want to pursue, that I wasn't able to give as much time as others would have liked, or even as much time as I would have wanted initially. Yeah, I figure it works out. Like, the main thing is, what drives you? That's a really good question, you know? What drives you? So if the drive within you is strong enough, and you surely will be able to find free time to do your stuff as well. And it's required. It's not just that every day I just go and work and work. You request some free time, right? That's what keeps your mind in check. That's what keeps you in balance in life in general.
Yeah.
So it's important to find the right fit and to find the right routine. I'd say that.
When exactly did you feel confident enough that you want to shift completely to quantum physics from civil engineering?
Okay, so there was this, I was taking, as I said, the course by Barton Zwieback on quantum mechanics. Okay, so there was this very important concept of coherent states. So I'm not going into detail. I would bore the audience out, I guess. So what I did was, so I had my own idea about how to improve and how to find a better explanation mathematically, or a mathematically more rigorous explanation of some of the physical aspects. So I tried, I continued my research on that, and eventually I had an idea. I had a mathematical structure to the idea. And I figured out that, yeah, I think it's good enough to be presented as a paper. So there was a very good professor, if you know, it's Krishnendu Mukherjee, is from the physics department. I went to him with his idea and he said, yeah, it's a viable idea. You can write a paper on it, even present in a conference. So that was the time I realized, yeah, I think I can do with it. I think it's a good thing for me to pursue quantum mechanics in future. And yeah, things just built on from there. And I was really liking the subject. So all things just fell into right places at the right time, to be honest. But yes, so after I had that idea, I knew that engineering to nahi hoga, kuch aur karna padega, because I'm really finding it interesting. Right? So that was the time, I'd say.
Yeah. So will you elaborate a bit on the research work you have done?
Okay. So my first idea was a bit more primitive. By primitive, I say, like, in quantum mechanics, there's a thing called the uncertainty principle. Yeah, you guys probably know about it. 7 and 11 and 12. So I had shown mathematically how uncertainty principle is related to the double slit experiment. So we all know it must be like uncertainty principle is one of the fundamental laws, you can say, of quantum mechanics. I had an idea of proving it mathematically, how it is directly related to the double slit experiment. So that was my initial idea. Then what happened was I presented my idea at S.N. Bose National Center for Basic Sciences to a professor over there. So, you know, I think even you guys are doing that sending multiple professors and multiple companies mails so that they can take you as an intern. Even I did that. I sent him my idea. So he said, okay, come over. You need to explain me the entire thing. But the trick was, you need to explain me the entire thing on board. Okay, so there was a chalkboard. I had to go there and present my idea and do the entire mathematical calculations on chalkboard. So, okay. So after a bit of grilling, he said, okay, I will take you as an intern. And I was then working as a research scholar, not a research scholar, it's a summer research intern at S.N. Bose National Center for Basic Sciences. And there I worked between Dirac equation. So in quantum mechanics, the initial governing equation for non-relativistic particles is called the Schrodinger equation. And when you go to the relativistic case, that governing equation becomes the Dirac equation. So in my second year internship, I did my internship on Dirac equation in Windler space-time, and it's mapping to 1 plus 1D black hole solution. So that's just technical mumbo-jumbo. What I did was finding the Dirac equation for a particle that near the effect of black holes. The thing is, in physics, there are two very perfectly good theories. One is the general relativity that explains the physics of the big, the large, the moons, the suns. The other is the theory for the very small objects, the atoms, the nucleus, the particles, and that's quantum mechanics. So I was trying to implement this quantum mechanics in the framework of general relativity and see how good this works. Just to be clear, it's a very difficult problem. It's has not been solved till now, but I was just trying to get a physical inclusion. Then what happened was my paper initially got accepted at American Physical Society for Physics, and I went to present my both these papers in the APS March and April meetings respectively. And after I visited America, the pandemic struck, so it was kind of in vain. So the entire thing went online. So I was there just at the last moment, I guess, before a day, the conference was canceled and the entire thing was held online. So after that, I came back and again, I started working. So I said that, yeah, conference papers are good, but I need something more concrete, maybe some publication in journals as well.
Yeah.
So next, I worked on the dilatation symmetries in planar non-commutative theory. Once again, technical mumbo jumbo. I won't bother with the details, but what it says is that the symmetries of a particle moving in a magnetic field, the symmetry properties that can be exploited and shown as a manifestation of quantum space-time. It was there. And after that, I'm currently working on something. So this, I think, is a fairly interesting topic. And I think I can label it without using very large terms to the audience. That is, whenever there's a magnetic field, there's a small magnetic field, and suppose you can control the magnetic field to a higher limit. So our current idea is that we can see this situation is similar to a particle moving near a black hole. So that is what we are trying to show, that the correlation between these two are very different but analogous pictures.
Yeah.
So that's all about my research until now. Yeah.
So during our BTEC years, few people aspire to crack CAT examination or GATE examination. Some also goes for UPSC. But what was your major focus during all those four years?
See, my major focus was, as I said, that from the second year, I thought to myself that, yeah, engineering is a very good option, but it's probably not meant for me. I'll just go for quantum mechanics. I'll just start doing research in quantum physics. So I decided, I talked to many people, not seniors per se from our college, seniors in life, seniors in different research institutes. And they all suggested me, yeah, you just keep doing research. And initially, you may have a profile so that you can try abroad. So I just followed their advice, and there's a group actually called Physics After Engineering. So that group helped me a lot. So there are many people, I'm not a very special case actually. There are many people who are trying to shift from engineering to physics, and they really wanted to pursue physics maybe for some kind of constraints in their life. They could not, but they want to do it right now. So there was a group, and those guys helped me really a lot. So I got advices from different people, and they helped me out in the end about how the procedure of, even if you want to study an MSc in India, that even that's a viable option right now. So that's how I decided that UPSC, CAT, and everything else, it's for others, it's not meant for me. I'll just go for my research.
So Bhaiya, how did you approach the Sorbonne University for your master's?
Okay, so what happened was, there is their website called the Paris Physics Master's Program. So I went there and saw the procedure. The procedure was quite fairly simple. There are two course coordinators, the head of the physics department, head of this program actually. So you need to send them an email saying that I want to apply, and you need to send few documents. These documents include your transcripts up till, for me, it was seventh or sixth semester. Up till the semester, I had got my transcripts, basically. You send your transcripts, you send your CV, you send your letter of motivation, which is very, very important. And these three things are what you need to send. And after that, they will if you're selected, then they will take an interview. And after the interview, if you get selected, they will just let you know. And for scholarship, after a few days, we'll again get a mail regarding the scholarship opportunities over there. So you up there, you need to answer two questions. One being, what are the why do you deserve a scholarship and why do you need a scholarship? So based on your entire file, that is your grades, your grades, your letter of motivation, your CV, your interview, and these documents that you send, will be once again be selected or not selected for a scholarship. So that's the entire procedure.
So obviously they are expecting higher grades.
Yeah. That's for universally true for anywhere you apply to, for any program, if it's research based. It's universally true. The higher the grades, the more are your chances. But for my cases, I don't really know. For my cases, the grades mattered because, you know, they were asking for grades in quantum mechanics and statistical mechanics. I had grades in hydraulics and water engineering. So they had a thorough interview and my interview went good. So maybe for me, that mattered. And I had many research projects. So even that might have counted in a lot.
Yeah.
So probably that.
Well, what
it's always important to have good grades, even if it's they are not very good. At least try to keep within 8.4, 8.5, because that shows that whatever you are doing by side, whatever research projects you are doing, it at least shows that you are a sincere student, right?
Yeah.
So even that is very important.
I have 8.5 exactly.
Yeah, I had less, but.
So, Bhaiya, what are you working on these days exactly?
So, these days, what I'm working on is like pretty neat actually. So, what we find out is like if there's a particle moving in a magnetic field, it's a particle moving in a high magnetic field and a particle moving in a very low magnetic field. So, the thing is, when you switch on from low magnetic field to higher magnetic field, that case is similar to when a particle is just moving in a normal flat space time and suddenly it approaches a black hole. So, we're trying to show that how these completely different pictures but are analogous to each other. So, this may have practical applications as well, you know, in simulating massive objects near the black hole, it'll just simulate one electron moving in regions of magnetic fields. So, that's it. So this is my current research.
So in the initial stage, how did you balance your finances in France?
I'm still actually in my initial stage. It's just been 2 days I've been there. Right? So what I did was so the thing is, they said me that I got a scholarship of around 5,000 euros. And actually, the thing with Europe is the application is free. The tuition fee ain't that much. The tuition fee is 250 euros a year. That's even less than one semester of our college fee, right? So it was not very difficult to manage. And I'll start getting the scholarship from somewhere, I think in October or September. I don't know actually from when I'll start getting. But once I get that, I think it would be pretty easy. Also, you have to do a compulsory internship. And that internship is mostly paid. Like in France, there's a rule that if any internship lasts more than 8 weeks or 2 weeks, sorry, 2 months, 8 weeks, then it has to be paid by the government. It's a rule, okay. Hard and fast, right? So, yeah, so you can even get paid through internships in the last 4 months, which is sort of compulsory. So I think if one lives frugally and a bit conservatively, he can easily walk around like with that kind of money. Like he may not be able to save because Paris, as you know, is extremely expensive compared to other cities, right? But he can definitely get around his own way. Can definitely at least live in an apartment, eat normal food, generic food, and survive. He can survive.
Yeah. So, Sankarshan Bhaiya, what was this one thing or who was this one person who always kept you motivated throughout this journey? Because most of the time it so happens that we dream something else and then when we can't do it, we just shift our mind that no, that wasn't our goal and we get into something different. Okay, which is not even our dream. Okay, so what was this one thing that helped you to reach where you are?
First of all, I have a very supportive family and my grandfather was very supportive of me doing all this. So he kept me motivated, really motivated. And second of all, it's all upon your interest and it's very, very important to have one focus and not be fickle-minded. I just can't stress how important this is. Like, I have seen many people one day they will be thinking of a startup career. Next day they will be like, okay, so I'm just going to go for GATE and just have a brilliant GATE exam. And next day they are like, no man, it's like MBA. First I need to gather some managerial experience with MBA and then I'll do a science. So there are a lot of people who have, they may have goals, but they don't know how to be totally focused and how to limit yourself. It's very, very important that you don't stay fickle-minded. You have one goal and you first really know, must really know that you really need to like it, okay? So that you can work hard. As I said, there's only one rule. Work hard for anything. You need to work hard to be successful. And that is actually being complemented by your passion towards what you are working. It's not that even if I hate the subject, I can be successful in something else. Okay, that's not an issue. There are many people who initially don't like, doesn't like the work they do, but they're very, very successful. The reason they really work hard, and that's a job. But what you need to make what you work hard for, your kind of hobby, kind of passion. And then that working hard becomes just so easy that it comes naturally to you. So first, don't be fickle-minded at all. And know that you'll be facing difficulty. There will be days when you will be feeling like, okay, I'll just give it up. What's the use? I'm not just progressing in it. But there will be again be days where you will feel like, yeah, at the top of the world, you can really do this.
Yeah.
Okay, so just find what you really like to work upon and just work, and don't be demotivated. So that you know that this is my goal, and I'm not shifting from it. And there is another thing that people try out a lot of things, right? So even you can do that. Like first, let's say you do some CAT preparation, then you do some GRE preparation for maybe if you're going to foreign abroad, maybe you'd go to this and that. But at the end of trying out all of these things, you must know what you want to do because that is very important. You can try out all things and say, okay, all of this is for me. I'm just going to go all out for all of it. That's never going to work. So yeah, you can try out different things. Definitely, engineering is a thing to do. And I just would like to point out that engineering as a branch is just so flexible, right? You can go to anywhere. Like I'm going into basic sciences. Some guys are going to management. Guys are going to core engineering. Guys are going to IT. So that's not an issue at all. You can try out many things. But at the end of the day, let's say before the start of the third year, you should ideally know what you really want to do. Or else you can even find out later in life and then work it out. But it's advisable that, say, during your third year and fourth year, you start really working hard for what you want to do. Right?